Good morning. Guten Tag. So today I'm going to do something differently. For all those who were here yesterday, it's going to feel like a new talk. Today I want to introduce myself to you, which is what my images are supposed to do. When I take images, the idea is to introduce them to my audience, whether they're local or whether they're international. I grew up in Jamaica. I grew up around images that did not make me or anybody that looked like me feel good. We're talking about what the industry called colonized or the colonist vision of the diaspora. They're usually images that look like this. Or our women half naked, breast very flat, flies all over their... I remember I did a seminar in Ethiopia with my camera, and I was instructed not to take a picture. For the 2 weeks I was there, there were people who were watching me as I worked to make sure that I did not photograph anybody in a disparaging way. Ethiopia was dubbed the face of poverty or the face of famine. And as a result, the government was making sure that nobody would take images that make Ethiopia look in a way that was disparaging. And so, imagine me growing up in Jamaica now, surrounded by images that did not reflect me. Imagine living in a country like the United States where all the images that we see are images that makes me the other. It seems normal. However, when I became a dad and my sons started to ask me questions like, you know, where are we from? What is our history? When my 10-year-old would come back and say to me, Dad, why do we have to learn about Christopher Columbus? And or where were the natives when Christopher Columbus came? I realized that I had to take the responsibility to show him who we are. And so these images are different from my daily. These images are the images that I go out and photograph so as to introduce me to you. I am hoping that when you see these images, they are your uncles, your brothers, your nieces, your nephews. And so I go out every day. I remember there's this photographer who knows Stanley Green, or know the name Stanley Green. Stanley Green, God rest his soul, died a couple years ago, told me once, he used to work for NOR. He was a member of NOR. I remember when I never used to get assignments, and I was going around photographing every day on the street. He said to me, you should never sit at home and expect somebody to give you an assignment. He said, get up every day and photograph as if you're going to work. And I did that. I did that for years. I would drop my sons off at 8 o'clock. I would pick them back up at 3:10, and between 8:30, and we have a thing in New York called alternate side parking. Who knows what that is? They sweep the street, so you have to move your car to the other side of the street. And so I would sit in my car and listen to NPR every day. And when I would listen for something that had a local viewpoint, and I would go chase it. I would just drive to that section of New York and look for those images. And let me start. So, for me, every image I take is a story unto itself. I remember when I discovered Richard Avedon, I was working at the Associated Press. And for me, photojournalism was connecting images. So if I'm going to photograph this room, I would take this couple right here, and I would look for this guy in his Guns N' Roses, and hopefully, at the end of the 15 images, I would have told a story, until I met Richard Avedon's work, and realized that one image can tell the story of 15 people. And so for me, the idea of a portrait is to pack into it all the stories that I can. Every New Year's Eve for the past 5 years, I go to Grand Central Station and I photograph everybody there from 12 o'clock to about 3 o'clock. I just walk around and photograph Grand Central Station. And these were my first images of 2018. We have a thing in Jamaica. Whatever the year sees you doing is what you're going to do for the rest of the year. So at 12 o'clock, this is my first picture. So that for the rest of the year, guess what I'm going to be doing? I'm going to be photographing. In fact, I've actually asked this guy every time that I've seen him if he could teach me the trumpet. This is still in Grand Central Station. This is also me using the GFX system. I had just gotten it into my hands, and I just wanted to test it. Nobody should be alone. Again, the premise is whatever the year comes in, whatever the year sees you doing is what you're going to be doing for the rest of the year. So for me, I was like, oh my God, she's going to be alone for the rest of the year. Because this is how the New Year's came and saw her. I also want to point out, I'm a writer first. So my story, every image that I show you, has the story in it. So I would never have photographed her without that balloon. It makes no sense for me. Like, I want you to go, it's either Christmas, birthday, New Year's. I want to put you in here immediately. And if you know anything about New York, you're not thinking birthday, because why would she be at this area where you can see Madison Square Garden? It has to be Grand Central Station. And all my images come back to this thing. This idea that I'm always trying to elevate this color to a place of equity. I'm always wondering, how do black people live with the trauma of being a second-class citizen? Somebody that has no rights. And Grand Central Station found this guy who sleeps in Grand Central Station for years with a book, The Declaration of Independence. I'm also going to show you what I do when I go home. Somebody told me recently that I photographed Jamaica better than I photograph anywhere else in the world. It's home to me. I see colors. I always want to, like, show you how I lived. So I grew up, how would I say this? I grew up poor, I think, in the sense of classish. I grew up poor. And so I always wanted to show you the rough edges. Something this beautiful with the rough edges. I want you to see a young kid already thinking about his future. His father, usually, this is a soup pot. So his father is selling soup on the street. And I remember standing up watching him, and I was just drawn to whatever he was thinking. The tragedy of this picture is I asked him for his signature for a model release, and he shook his head. And I said, I really need this because I can't use it. Fuji will not allow me to use this image without your signature. And he goes, I can't write. And I'm drawn to these people, because if I can amplify that voice, who is going to amplify that voice. If I can't be a conduit between him and us, who's going to do it? He has been fishing for like 20 years. I stalked them for a while. So a part of who I am is, again, self-assignments. I like to give myself self-assignments because I am so accustomed to editors not really interested in the black story. My 27 years in America, I can tell you that it's only over the past 4 years that you've seen magazines starting to tell the black experience. So it has always been up to black artists, black photographers, to put out, whether at galleries, on their own feeds, the black experience. This wall exists right outside my door. And so I decided to go out and photograph everybody that I see coming down the subway. This is my son. Of course, I dragged him out there to sign the model releases, to get them signed for me. But again, I want to introduce you to black folk, for lack of a better way of saying this. I want you to see people who normally you wouldn't engage with. I'm always attracted to older men because I never had a very good relationship with my dad. My dad was an alcoholic, and so it was a very strained relationship. So whenever I meet a man who is a, my father died in 2007. Whenever I meet a man who's close to his age, I am fascinated to ask him questions. And I get to do this through photography. This guy is a worker from Guyana. If I showed you, and I'm going to do something, I am not mimicking him. I want to show you how I take pictures. If you saw him, if he was to turn up here, this is what you would see. This is the guy. But the way I photograph him, I want to always show you an image with integrity. I want to show you a man, a human. I am not going to show you the victim or the parts that make him less whole. You should never in my image see the defunct or the broken parts of a human being. And that's my goal in taking portraits. I was asked by an editor once, can you photograph white people? And I said, do you ask all the white photographers that go to Africa if they can photograph black people? So that image is there as proof. And you guys are my witness. I'm always fascinated by the African Americans. How should I say this? Their affinity to holding on to the flag. Now for me, and as an outsider, Jamaican, coming to America, this flag represents second-class citizenship. It represents slavery. It represents the reason why Colin Kaepernick is kneeling. It represents everything that's painful. Yet, I have a series of just African-Americans holding on to this flag. And when I ask them, why do you wear this flag? Simple answer, I am American. And the idea, my idea to photograph them is to say, yes, you are American. And I want to involve you within the conversation of who an American is. Again, you wouldn't believe that he's an alcoholic, he's high, he's drunk. My father was an alcoholic. I can tell you for a fact that my father and I, he died when I was, 40. We never had a conversation over half an hour, never in our lives. And so I'm always drawn to have conversations. And I never want to show that. Like, I hope you can see that he's high. But it's there. I know he's high. He's unkempt. His lips. But I am going to show you the best of who he is. The image of the black man that is put out into the world is one that he's lazy. He's not a good father. He doesn't work. I always want to show how beautiful they can be. This woman raised me. This is my mom. She visits every 4 months. Right now, she's cooking my family dinner. My wife said she hid the pictures from me because she knows that I'll be dying here in Germany looking at all the food that my mom is cooking. But every time I think about who I am, my mom has this question that she asks me. She goes, "Ruddy, did I do a good job?" And every time I take a portrait, I would like to think that this is the reason why I take this portrait, because of her upbringing. I worked at Vogue for 2 years, and so I like to think that there's a little fashion sense to how I posed people. You can tell that I shot this in December. Again, I am drawn to spaces where people are struggling to create an identity for themselves. Afropunk is a space in Brooklyn. It's also in England. They're moving to South Africa, where people come together to explore, to announce to the world that I am different, but I should also be included in the conversation. And so they hired me. It's a place where people are fabulous. They wear extravagant clothes. And Afropunk hired me to find the social justice quality to their festival. And so I went around looking for people who gave a statement. I know that you guys might be watching what's happening in the confirmation of Kavanaugh right now. This girl chose to wear a t-shirt that says, "Rape is rape," that you have to battle with what's going on. However, not without the fashion sense, which is what Afropunk is. Afropunk is about fashion, but it's also about self-realization. It's also about who we are. Again, there's also the space of, some people would like to say, redefining masculinity. I would like to say it's including all definition of masculinity. This is the Afro part of the punk, where there's this homage to what is Africa and what is the diaspora. If anybody's curious, this is the 110 millimeter lens on the GFX. Can anybody tell me if I'm using flash or not? Am I using flash? Say it loud, brother. Say it loud. The light, we call it the catch light. Again, my image should be self-explanatory. The idea that here is a man who is revealing that I don't have to fit the stereotypical idea of who a man is. And as soon as he opened up the curtain, I realized that this is my image. The idea of him revealing himself to the world. The idea of not having a voice. I also look for images that support my thesis or my series. I am going to go seek out images, put them together so that it could be a more solid series. And of course, this guy walked around with his mouth zipped. Anybody know the story about Colin Kaepernick? This was a homage to him. I did not, it wasn't a mistake that I put him between two things that look like the Twin Towers. The idea was to create this idea of protests and jar you. Again, I was excited that this brother who came fashionably came also with his protest. These are all people that were killed by police officers in America. The lights behind his head are not, what's the word? They're not a fluke. I moved around until they created that arch. Because it's also about these lines all over him. That I wanted to have this aesthetic of this line moving in the image. These lines. I'm also fascinated about finding spaces to create. I don't have a lot of space most of the times. Like, it's sometimes like this. And I have to turn around, move around, and look for something that would isolate a person that I want to photograph. Of course, the sun is important. These are, how do I say it in America? They are the toilets outside, porta potties. I remember photographing it. Somebody passed by and go, "You really photograph her in front of a porta potty?" In my mind, I didn't see the porta potty. I saw the image because I knew what the lens was going to do. I knew that I could blur it enough, but I also wanted the green. I wanted the splashes of green to resonate. Again, I might say some things and I do not want you to take them out of character, but most of the work that I'm doing in America now has a lot to do with the black experience. Most of the assignments I get from Time or Nat Geo or the New York Times send me to the south of America where most of the stories are predominantly black. Cairo is a little town in Illinois where over the course of, let's say, 60 years, do anybody know what white flight is? Like, white folks just leave. And the economy drops because black folks do not have resources. They do not have the ports. They do not have the businesses. And as white folks left Cairo, the city or the town became blighted. And again, I'm always, always, the question I ask is, how do you wake up every day and feel proud as a human being? This is one of the things, actually one of the things that, anybody know who Albert Camus is? Albert Camus said, and let me get this right, a soul that knows, oh my God, I'll remember it. I can easily do this. What am I doing? This is a smartphone, right? All I have to do is go to my, give me a second, Albert Camus. Ready? It says, when a soul has suffered, it develops a taste for the misfortune. People ask me all the time, why is it that when I go into black neighborhoods, they're always laughing, they're always smiling, as if they enjoy where they're living. And I would point them to Camus. I would say, when a soul has suffered, it develops a taste for the misfortune. That is all he knows. And so, Bed-Stuy, Alabama, Chicago, Detroit, all look like this. And I would question, why is it that black folk seem to find this comfortable? And I would go in and realize that when this is all you know, this is it. Why is it that, a question my wife and I used to ask, why is it that when you go, when white folks come into a neighborhood, it springs up? Well, why should I pick up garbage? Like how I grew up in Jamaica, this street doesn't belong to me. I'm just walking on the street, I see garbage, I take it up, and at the next garbage, I throw it down. That's my community. That's something that most African Americans do not have. They don't have it because it was never theirs. So they'll pass garbage and they will live in it. And you wonder why, when a soul has suffered. And so, this was actually on my way to Cairo. I saw this flag and I pulled over carefully, go on this, because they'll shoot you to be on their property. I had to be on the edge. I sat up on the car and I looked up, I looked down, took a couple snaps, make sure I had it, look up again, then I rolled out. The magazine used that as the cover. This was also a cover piece. It's here. This is the movie theater. That's the fire department. No longer has a fire department. The theater no longer shows movie. But this used to be the gem of Cairo. This woman grew up in this neighborhood. She has since moved to Chicago. So when I was interviewing her, she was telling me all that has changed in the community. She went as far as to tell me that when Martin Luther King came, that was the beginning of white flight. This was a couple I photographed who the school, I think, I don't want to misquote the superintendent, but I think the school has 20 students. This is the prom king and queen. This is one of the activists that has been trying to help the rejuvenation of Cairo. This used to be the Baptist Church bus. This is the community he lives in. He was actually one of the star members of the story. Star student, star athlete. But this is his reality. Imagine waking up every day, going to school. This is your reality. This is what you see every day. Why would that soul, that child, reach for anything more? That's his father. This is his friend. They just smoked, so they're happy. This is, Cairo is like 2 kilometers, or is that 2 miles? Are they the same kilometers or miles? What's the difference? So which is bigger, miles? All right, so Cairo is about 2 miles long. This is what you're looking at the town. This is it. There's no gas station. I had to go to another state to get gas. So imagine, I drove with whatever little gas, because I didn't know. I thought I could just pull over in a gas station. So the needle was like hitting E, like. So by the time I get gas and come back, I'm at half a tank. I'm done. Like, I have to go back again. This is your reality. And these are the guys responsible for. They were commissioned to boarding up the houses. The most beautiful part of the story is they're both ex-convicts. They both have jobs. And so I felt a sense of relief to know that they had gainful employment. But again, they had the dirty job of going into a community that they live in to board up the community. I think this is the last story. So I would say that my photography was influenced mostly by becoming a dad. For instance, I loved to fight. Whether it was with words or with my fist, I fought every day. If there was 200 days in a school year, I fought 198. And my mother was a teacher in our community too. So imagine my mom getting the call, Mrs. Roye, your son again. Every day. Granted, I was this tall in high school. And I was a little skinnier than now. Like, I never had weight. And so I would just always fight. And I remember one day I was on the football field and the referee would never give me a call. I was a good football player. I could have played for Bayern Munich or Cologne. My son loves Bayern. But we've been talking about Cologne for the past couple of days. He's like, Dad, they wear red and white. I'm like, ah. He's been researching. So I'm on the field. I'm getting kicked. No call. So I walked over to the referee and I said to him, who is going to protect you if I get one more hit? And he immediately took that as a threat, stopped the game. It became this big argument. And a guy, an old guy from the other team, walked over to me. I'm already like, why is he coming over to me? And he said, the biggest job you have in your life is to get back home to your kids. And it impacted me. I haven't fought since. He said, get home to your kids. And I think it was a precursor to understanding my role as a dad. And not so much my role as the photographer, the breadwinner. I started to see myself as an example. And the best way I could do that was to be. And so Time Magazine called me and they go, because of my presence on Instagram, I'm always putting up stories of me and my sons. And they go, we want you to go across the United States and photograph what fathers are telling their sons. If I was a better businessman, I would have put up the video that day so that you guys could see it. Or if I'm good, I will do it for tomorrow's talk. I will insert a video that Time put up where fathers talked about what they talk to their kids about. So, this was in Baltimore. I don't know if you guys know about anything about the States, but I went to school in Baltimore. I remember when I hit the streets of Baltimore, I asked a woman that was at the side of the street, and I said, I am looking for fathers to photograph for this series. And she said, it's going to take you a while. And I was like, what do you mean by it's going to take me a while? She said, the fathers are not here. They're in prison. Or they're out. And so I called my cousin. She lives in Baltimore. And I said, I need a father. And she goes, I can find you one. Single dad, raising two sons. And I went to his house. He's a crab. He cooks crab for a living. And he raises his two boys. This is my cousin's husband. And so I knew I at least had one. You know, I call my cousin and I'm like, okay, I have one. But in talking to him, his kids are like 4 and 7, and he's already talking to them about how to be on the streets, how to relate or engage with a police officer. What dreams have you started to talk to your kids about? I remember going up to this young man and I said, I'd like to photograph you for a series. And he goes, I don't think my son is gonna want to. And I knew, like, I was in a very tough neighborhood. It is not the most, how should I say this? Guys like him do not like the cameras. Guys like him do not like their friends seeing them talking to somebody with a camera. Words like feds, words like snitch, words like police come up. So he was already like on guard, like, no. But this is the way he slid out of it. He said, I don't think my son is going to want to be photographed. So I ran over to his son, because he didn't know who Ruddy was. I ran over to his son, I'm like, I would love to photograph you and your dad. Of course, let's go. His father was pissed, but I got this. And again, where the place in Baltimore that they live, gunshots all the time. So he's already telling his son how to live, what time you come back, you come home. And they're at a barbershop, and he's with his son at the barbershop. Like he said, there's spaces that I just don't allow my son to go to by himself. I was actually, this was in Oakland. I was in a restaurant. Again, this was one of the first assignments that I got where, left my rag, where Time Magazine did not set up any of the portraits. They were basically like, go do what you do. Go into the neighborhoods, meet people, photograph people. I'm like, okay, all right. It's always easier when you move from the hotel to the place that you're gonna photograph, you're done. I had to go find people. So I'm in the restaurant, and I see him walking in with his son, and I was like, over there. And we talked for a long time. He's a photographer, but he has a mixed child. He has to talk to his child about both sides. Beautiful story. I'm in Oakland. I have never met a place like Oakland. Resolute, revolutionary. Every male that I spoke to felt like they could go to war the next day. The schools, one of my biggest problems with schools in America is my son does not get to learn anything about who he is. He learns Christopher Columbus. He learns about... And I learned through a story that Nat Geo gave me who Nat Turner really was. Nat Turner started an insurrection in Virginia. in August. In December of that same year, there was an insurrection in Jamaica. We had that guy on our money. His name is Sam Sharp. So at 2 years old, 3 years old, 4 years old, a child in Jamaica gets a paper dollar. He looks on it. He sees Sam Sharp. And he goes, "Mom, who is this guy?" And Mom goes, "Oh, that's Sam Sharp. He fought for your liberation." In America, Nat Turner is nowhere to be found. So I had to go home. I actually drove the place where Nat Turner planned the interaction to where he was captured with his great-great-great-great-grandson. And we talked the entire way. And I kept asking him, why isn't this in our curriculum? A couple weeks ago, I found this quote that said, why would a country educate a people to overturn it? And I was like, oh, I get it. So, my admiration for men, for black men in Oakland is their schools teach them about themselves. Most of the schools that these guys go to, there's a black curriculum. This son goes to a school that most of the curriculum is African-based. They're both Jesses. I met young Jesse when I was doing a story on young black men in Jackson, Mississippi, who were living with AIDS. And I remember, it's so funny that you should never judge people. There were these young boys on top of a wall doing their hip hop. And I was just watching them going, man, these young kids. The next day when I was back in New York, Jesse was on his Instagram with like mega guns. Because it's legal. They were all legal. But we started to have a dialogue. And I told him that I was coming back to Jackson, Mississippi to photograph him and his dad. And so he said, come to my barbershop. And his father turned up. And it was us. It was beautiful to sit down in a barbershop and listen to Jesse and his friends talk about what it meant to grow up in Jackson, Mississippi. I want, for an hour, one of his friends sat down and talked about the abuse he got from his mom. And I was like, wishing. First, they were talking about murders. There was a guy that I had met who was on the wall that was killed like months later. So I couldn't tape. Like, I wouldn't want to put that on tape. But right after that, he went into a conversation about the abuse he got from his mom. And I was like, that should have been taped. And I said, I need to meet your father. I think I might find that picture and put it in tomorrow. But it's a beautiful picture of a father and son. This picture was shot in Chicago. The Sheik, it has been responsible for going into the South Side and trying to quell the gun violence on the South Side. This is his son. This is in Louisville, Kentucky. And again, it seems simple, but this is important to me. The fact that it's a crumbling wall. This guy lives in Indiana. And at one point, he was practically chased out of Indiana by the residents because he's married to a white woman. His sons are mixed. And it was as simple as this. He went to church. The pastor took him to the vestry and said, you're really not welcome in our community anymore. And so he had, yeah. Like the pastor, not a member of the church, the pastor took him around the back and was like, and I guess how he put it was, I'm doing this for your own safety.
Thank you.